In this lecture, we'll talk about the human eye and how cameras for astronomy work. I've mentioned that most of the information we have about the universe comes from looking solely at light. We collect this light with telescopes and record it with cameras and other instruments. Telescopes and cameras function much like the eye, so it makes sense to first talk about the principles of eyes and cameras. Let's start with the eye. Its basic components are a pupil, lens, and retina. The pupil controls how much light enters the eye. The lens bends light to form an image on the retina, and the retina contains light-sensitive cells called cones and rods that, when triggered by light, send signals to the brain via the optic nerve. Most of the cones are located here on what's called the fovea centralis or macula. These are rod and cone cells. The cones provide the eye's color sensitivity, whereas the rods are responsible for our dark adapted vision. We have many more rods than cones, about 120 million rods versus 6 to 7 million cones. This is why the world looks in shades of gray and black in low light conditions. When you walk into a dark space, it takes about 10 minutes for your eyes to adjust. This is actually the amount of time that the rods need to activate and take over for the cones. We are able to see dimmer objects in our peripheral vision because that's where the rods dominate. For example, if you see a dim star in your peripheral vision, it may disappear when you look at it directly, since you are moving the image onto the cone-rich fovea region, which is less light sensitive. There's a planetary nebula I like to show at our observatory nights. It's nicknamed the blinking planetary. When you look directly at the blinking planetary through the telescope, you can only see the dead core at the center and not the surrounding atmosphere, the nebula part. But if you look at it with peripheral vision, the nebula part becomes visible. You can make the planetary nebula appear to blink on and off by looking at it indirectly and then directly. The rods in our eyes do not see red. This is why astronomers use red lights in observatories. Since the rods do not respond to red, you can gain full dark adapted vision in red light. Once your eyes have adapted to the dark, if you look at anything with a white light, even for a moment, you have to wait for your eyes to become dark adapted all over again. Red lights won't ruin your night vision like a white light can. The lens in your eye functions the same as a lens in a magnifying glass or telescope. All lenses bend light. This bending of light is called refraction. Parallel rays of light, like those coming from a distant star, converge to a point called the focus or focal plane. The fact that parallel rays of light converge to a sharp focus is why distant stars appear as points of light to our eyes or in photographs. The image formed by a lens is actually upside down. Our eyes form upside down images, which are flipped right side up by our brains. If we want to keep an image for study, we need to record it. Astronomers use sophisticated digital cameras to record images. Inside digital cameras are electric chips called charge-coupled devices, or CCDs. A CCD is physically divided into grids or pixels. When a photon strikes a pixel, it causes a bit of electric charge to accumulate. Each subsequent photon striking the same pixel adds to this accumulated electric charge. The astronomical images you see have, in most cases, been processed. Image processing can sharpen or adjust colors, correct exposure issues, and remove defects from an image. I'll leave you with this interesting piece of information about the eye. In the 1950s, an Austrian professor named Theodor Erismann had his student assistant, a man named Ivo Koller, wear a pair of hand-engineered goggles. Inside those goggles, specially arranged mirrors flipped the light that would reach Koller's eyes. Top became bottom and bottom became top, so that Koller was seeing the world upside down. At first he stumbled around, but after a little over a week, his brain compensated and he could function completely as normal with the goggles. He was even able to drive his motorcycle. it's an interesting example of neuroplasticity. Our brains can be quite adaptive. That's it for now. Enjoy your day or your night. I will talk to you again soon.